My girlfriend for how long? Long time. Don't even go.
35.
More.
Because I said, it's a song.
Turn it down.
No, that's okay.
No.
But I can't speak above it. It's a little hard.
No. Come on, hurry up. I have an assistant who's going to help you.
Oh, I love her.
Just turn it down.
She'll get an A at the end of the semester.
Not right now, I don't. Maybe later.
Are you in my class?
Yes.
Oh, good. What's your name again?
Sophie.
Sophie? Spell it.
S-O-H-E.
Oh, Sohee. I like that.
Sophie.
It's a Korean name.
Young lady, are you in my class? Sit over here, okay?
No, stay right here.
Yeah, you're the technical master. You stay there.
Girl, Sophie, stay right there, baby.
See? Now, you see, we had to give that seat to the technical master, otherwise we don't have it. Everything has a place. Okay. Let me start. I have some good news, but first I want to welcome all of you. This is the first serious class because we have an outstanding guest speaker. Now, which one am I? This is the one. Okay. Now, I'm going to make announcements. It says no drink, no water, because that's what they told me, and no cell phones. That I appreciate. And what else do you have to do? That's enough for today, because I want to get Audrey up here on the stage. But I want to make a few announcements. Turn off that cell phone, please. It's nerve-wracking. Next week, we have David Wolf, who is the creative director of the Doniger Group. Outstanding. I always have him follow Audrey, because Audrey is the lead of this class. She'll set you in the right frame of mind for your future. And September 22nd, write this down, because these are important people. Jane Elfers, she is the new CEO chairman of Lord & Taylor. She has turned that store around to what it was. It's beautiful. Have you been to Lord & Taylor recently? Okay, go. If you haven't, go take a look so when she comes, you can make comments about it, okay? Get knowledgeable about what she's done with Lord & Taylor. It's different than it was. So, and she's been written up about, she's part of everything important in fashion. So get to know her, network, get her card, and you know, for your future, with all of them. And get friendly with Audrey, she's nice. And September 29th, I have Andrew Rosen, the CEO of Theory. You like Theory?
Yes.
He is, and he's the son of one of the most brilliant men in this fashion world, right? His father was, I forgot his father's name, Andrew's father. But anyway, he is, No, that's another one. Anyway, on October 6th, we have a very sensitive, special, wonderful man called Joseph Barato, and he's the president of JJB Consultants, and he's been working for people like Ralph Lauren, Polo. In fact, they started together when Polo happened. And he has a lot of information and knowledge, both design. He was the CEO of Brioni, the Italian tailor of kings. He was a guest speaker here. And he's Bergdorf Goodman and Brooks Brothers. And he's been in every important area of merchandising, buying. And after that, I'm waiting for Fashion Week to be over, because I've asked Narciso Rodriguez and many of the designers, because first I'm having people who are in merchandising and other areas of fashion, but I also will bring to you fashion designers as soon as their heads settle down after the shows on the 15th or the 14th, yes. Okay, that's one bit of news. Now, also, please, Giorgio Armani is having runway shows, and he needs volunteers to do various things he gave here. He's putting on four runway shows, September 16th and 17th, two a day. So if you want information about that and you want to sign up, please come to room A, what's my room? A629. It's on your card, because I never go there. It's A639, not 29. A639. All right, so come to room A639 and you can sign up for whatever. It's free. It's 16th and 17th. Two a day he's doing. Emporio Armani on the 17th. I don't want to take up time going into detail. You can come up to my office, my room. It's your house, too. Now, I'm dying to ask Audrey to come up here, and she doesn't like me to talk too much about her, but I'm going to say she's one of the most dynamic contributors to American fashion that I know. And we've had a long friendship that I'm proud of, and she's a woman of the 21st century, born in New York. She's been on Oprah, The Home Show, The Today Show, The Good Morning Hotel, name it. She is sought after by everyone because she's just that way. And she was with Ebony Magazine and traveled all over Europe. And when I went to Rome, every designer in Rome, you say Audrey Smaltz, they loved her. Valentino, Tiziani, so on, Tito Rossi, and here is Audrey. She doesn't want me to talk anymore.
Hi, sweetie. We're gonna run my press kit. It's a small video. And so you can just it's 3.5 minutes. Well, they were running it all along. This is the back of it. They'll start it from the beginning.
I know that she's in charge of my show and getting those girls ready. I feel at ease.
We are the ones who set up the racks. We are the ones who press the clothes, who put the clothes back in where they're supposed to be put back together. We make sure that every hook and eye is done.
Audrey's crew are the most professional, and it's a wonderful, wonderful thing to have people that really help this much, because they are as important as anyone else in this endeavor.
I've done shows in Paris and New York for many, many years, and in Paris I always said, where's Audrey Smaltz and the ground crew, because it makes everything run perfectly and smoothly. Audrey, I think, just brings great energy also to the room.
Her crew is so surrounded by spiritual energy, we get pulled into their energy. They make it happen with such a degree of calm, professionalism, and spirituality. And it all stems from that heart.
I'm so glad to be here. You guys know my name, but I like to tell you that I was born bred, toasted, buttered, jelly jammed, and honeyed in Harlem. And now I live on 55th Street, just off Fifth Avenue, in a wraparound penthouse, and Donald Trump moved in my neighborhood. I've been there for 31 years. I've been in business for 31 years. I've been in the fashion business for 55 years. I know I don't look my age. Wow. I've been around. And I've been coming here to FIT to speak to students just like you for more than 20 years. But my good friend Professor Papazian has had me come here now for the last 15 years, always to open up her very first series of the most fantastic people that you're ever gonna meet at this level. And you're gonna get to know them because they take time, they wanna be with you, they wanna get to know you better. So I remember it was 7 years ago and it was September the 10th, 2001. I was here. We had just done the Betsy Johnson show. It was at Tavern on the Green. And I stayed here with the young people till about 5:30 or 6:30, whatever. And we know what happened the next day. We were just so happy and we were just right into it. And so enjoy now. Enjoy this moment, because it's about you. So how did I get started? You just saw a little bit about me. It's the ground crew. What do? We do fashion shows, fashion shoots, and fashion videos. Now, this is the week that's called what?
Fashion Week.
Fashion Week, I didn't hear you.
Fashion Week.
And I'm sure some of you are working some of those shows. How many of you are working some of the fashion shows as dressers or whatever? Are you getting paid?
No.
Well, when you work for the ground crew, guess what?
You get paid.
However, ever since I came up with this idea to have a professional group of people to run a fashion show backstage, I've always had competition of free. Friends, family, and students at FIT. And Parsons, oh, it doesn't matter. Because I went above that. In order to go above that and be the best, the most expensive, the most sought after, and I will tell anybody, why would you want to hire a volunteer to dress your collection, which you have spent more than $200,000-$300,000 on preparing this for that person who doesn't really care, to not have it on the right model at the right time, dressed just right, zipped up, hooked-eyed, seam, no strings hanging, just perfect. That's where they let us down. Is this too loud? Do you hear? It's kind of feedback on me. It's feedback. Anyway, I knew this. So how did this happen? I created something that there never was before. So now I want you to think about it. As I'm telling you my story, what is it that you can create, make happen, that's not there now? It's called a missing. Something is missing. I would say, fashion editor for Ebony magazine. I'm in Paris, I'm in Milan, I'm in Florence, I'm in Rome, and I'm going to fashion shows. Now, not all the time did, this is the 1970s, not all the time did we have tickets, invitations to get into these shows. Well, in those days, I was the same height, but half the size. And they thought I was a model. I went backstage with many of the models, and many of the models were the same complexion as I was. So they just thought I was one of the regular girls. In fact, I was a fashion writer for a magazine, a fashion editor. I went backstage and I noticed things. What did I notice most? I noticed that the models would take stuff. You know, earrings, sunglasses, pair of shoes, because you know they all have big bags. You see these big bags? Man, they just put it in a bag. And then sometimes I'm back there and I'm watching it and I notice I could see the fabric better, because if I didn't have an invitation, or if I did have an invitation, I wasn't on the front row, I could feel the fabric, see the fabric. And then I said, well, who's dressing these people? Oh, it was just anybody. It was a cousin, it was a friend, it was a friend of a friend, it was the bookkeeper, it was the receptionist. But I don't know, it was interesting, I loved it. And I wanted to start my business because I was going to turn that time. I was going to be 40 years old soon. And I said, I've worked for a lot of people. Now, I don't want to work for anybody anymore. And I was at Ebony, and I left August the 31st, was my last day in 1977. But just before I left, I wanted to tell a friend of mine who was in her own business of designing textiles and doing the most incredible fabrics, working for the most incredible designers and manufacturers, that I wanted to go into business for myself, and that was Alice Papazian. I went to her office because I had saved up $60,000. That was a lot of money. That's not a lot of money, honey. I'm gonna tell you about that story. I spent it right away. Anyway. And I told her my idea, what I wanted to do, and she helped me out, and she gave me some kind of basis on how much I should charge. What I should charge for. Well, at that time, I'm just gonna be a consultant. That sounded good to me. I didn't think about this ground crew, did not quite at that moment. It kind of just happened. So I've always done fashion shows. I would go to fashion shows. I'd be backstage. I knew what went on at fashion shows. So bingo, you need to do what you're good at, what you know that you can do, what you're proficient at, what you can do, what you have a passion for, what you can do. That's what you should do. Because you'll love it. So I sent out some letters, 100. I had a little computer in that time, wasn't, you know, but I licked every envelope and I licked every stamp because they didn't have envelopes that had, you know, and the stamps. You wouldn't know that. That was 31 years ago. Not quite, maybe 30. So to make a long story short, I sent out 100 letters. I got 3 phone calls and 1 job. You know, I was crushed. I thought everybody wanted the ground crew. I wrote to every designer I knew. I knew them all because I did the Ebony Fashion Fair. I knew everybody. I knew they were waiting for me. They were not waiting for the ground crew or Audrey Smaltz or nothing. I got 1 job. I convinced the bookkeeper. She was tired of dressing these little fashion shows in her showroom, because the shows used to be in showrooms. And they would happen all day long for 3 or 4 days. And they would have the buyers come in and they have the press come in, very small, have a little lunch. And she convinced Tick Tenair. Her name was Miket Schrader, Abe Schrader. She's not in business anymore. I am. It's not easy being in the fashion business. Well, anyway, they hired us. And then she said, oh, but your dresses, their nails are so long. Oh, you know, and you charge so much money. Oh, I said, but I guarantee you. Now here was the niche. It's a niche within a niche. Because if my competition is gonna be free, and I'm gonna charge you, why are you gonna pay me? How can I convince you that we are the best? Huh? Just start now. Now nobody really knows. They know I'm good at when I was the editor, but they don't know what I can do on my own. Guess what I guaranteed them? That nothing would be missing. really? Because they have been putting on fashion shows for years, and there's always what? A pair of earrings missing, a bracelet is missing, something is always missing. So this was what I guarantee, and I still, to this day, guarantee that nothing is missing. And don't think I haven't found some things in big bags. Oh, and the designer said I could have that, Audrey. No, she did not. Because designers have to be nice. They don't want to tell the models who they love with a passion that no, you cannot have that dress. No, you cannot have that. I tell them. I get a bang out of telling them they can't have something. So I started this company from scratch. Nobody wanted to hire us. So that first job, I wrote the letter myself, put it on her, ladies put it on the stationery. She signed it. Sent it out to a lot of people. I think maybe I got one job or two jobs, I don't know. And I stuck with it. It is busy now. This is Fashion Week. I don't like Fashion Week anymore. I like when it was 7th on 6th. When it was 7th on 6th, it really had a ring. Now it's Fashion Week and they have Fashion Week all over the world. So it just sounds like it's ordinary. You know, when it's too much of the same, you want to be exclusive, don't you? You want to be original. So 7th on 6th is because when 7th Avenue went to 6th Avenue, that's how it became 7th on 6th. But anyway, it's Fashion Week. And Fashion Week for the ground crew this year started August the 25th because we do pre-production. It's not just a fashion show. So we do a lot of things. We do tailoring, we do seamstress work, we do steaming, ironing, we do fittings, we fit the models, and then we do fashion shows. So I would say all in all, between August the 25th and our last show so far was the 17th of September, but we still could be getting some more things in. We'll probably have about 100 jobs, of which 36 are fashion shows. Today we have 7 fashion shows. This is Monday the 8th. We opened up with Peter Somm. From Peter Somm, we went to Catherine Melandrino. From Catherine Melandrino, we went to, let me see, I know we had Diesel. Diesel, we went to Zizenia. Zizenia, we have Tony Cohen. Tony Cohen, we have Gotex, and tomorrow it goes on, and Wednesday there are 9 shows. So pray for us, because this, as Ruth Finley said, who writes the fashion calendar. You know about the fashion calendar? You can't do anything without a fashion calendar. She schedules designers when they can show. She said more than 200 designers wanted to be within a scope of 9-5 to 9-12. How can you put in 200 fashion shows in those days so you have many shows happening at the same time? What I love doing, and people say, well, do you just work, you know, just during Fashion Week? No, we work all year long. I heard you giving that job out about Giorgio Armani. See, that's what they want, free volunteer. Now that makes me mad. Because Armani charges $5,000-$10,000 for a suit, but they want a volunteer. That's not right. I've been fighting that. So I'm gonna go after that job, and we'll get it. Because I will convince them, because you have to know how to sell. So if you want to go into business for yourself, you have to know how to sell.
No one volunteers.
No, but there's so many volunteers, because people will, you know, you will hopefully let you gonna meet Giorgio. You're not gonna meet Giorgio Armani. He's not gonna be there. You'll meet a salesperson. But this is what happened. But we do a lot of these shows. We work for Prada, we work for Christian Dior, we work for Gucci. We work for a lot of people, as you saw on that my press kit. But it didn't happen overnight. So that's a lesson you must learn. It doesn't happen overnight. It takes time. I know there's instant tea and instant coffee. Who wants it? I want brewed tea and brewed coffee. I want the best. So what you want to be is the best. You want to be better than the best, and you want to be top, top dog. I don't care what it is that you want to do. It has to be fabulous, amazing, brilliant. And guess what? It has to make money. You know, you hear so many people, you know, I'm a stylist. I do personal shopping. I do, da, da, da. And I say, you making any money? No. No. So you have to think about, before you go out on your own, how are you gonna be satisfied, happy, have a passion for, love what you do, and then make money? Think about that. So it may not be now, because you're too young now. You need to work for someone, a big corporation or a small group, a small designer, a big designer, a huge, could be Macy's. Macy's is real huge, 880 stores. Lord & Taylor, not so huge. You might want to work for somebody and find out what it is that they're doing and how can you do it better. Don't try to do it better. Learn how they're doing it before you try, oh, I can do that better. Don't be that fast, because a lot of you are fast. So, but it's possible. So you see the possibility out there? It's possible for you to be whatever you want to be, and it'll be right on time, whether it's you're going to get married, have a baby, have two babies, be a wonderful housewife and mother. That might be what you want. But you want to be the best. You may be whatever it is, the designer, merchandise, whatever. I always wanted to do something different. Oh, here comes a good friend of mine, a wonderful designer. So you have to decide, what is it that you want to be? But before we get there, there are a few things that I want to, what I call house cleaning, or just cleaning up some mess with you young people. You don't know how to talk on the telephone. She's texting. Oh, you writing down what I'm saying? Oh my goodness. How come you don't have a little recorder? That's easier with a recorder. Those two thumbs are moving, baby. Listen, you don't know how to talk over the phone. I answer the phone. Good afternoon, ground crew. This is Audrey. May I help you? What time is that show? Where am I supposed to be at 4:45? Excuse me, did you tell me your name? So last night, young lady's name, what I heard on her phone that probably needed more charging, because you know you're on your cell phone. You're not at a landline. Am I right? You're on your cell phone, and she said, my name is Andrea. I thought she said Andrea. And she said it very fast, Andrea. So I said, Andrea? No, Andrea. Her name was Angera. I said, spell that, A-N-G-E-R-R-A. Fast, she spelled it fast. I said, you know what? Angera, that's a beautiful name. Do you know anybody else with that name? She said, no. I said, well, every time you tell somebody your name, you have to spell it. She has one of a kind name. People get on the phone, young people, not old people, because I'm not old. I am 71 years young. And you're younger. You got that? You're younger. I'm young. You're younger. So if you ever say old, that's your problem, not mine. However, when you get on the phone, the first thing you should say, if the phone rings and somebody, I'm calling somebody, I'm calling your office. Hi, this is Audrey Smaltz, and I'd like to speak to Donna Karen. The first thing I say is, hello, hi, my name is, what my name is, first and last name, not first name. Today we had a guy called named David. We got a lot of Davids calling us. You're not so special that you think they know who you are. You must say your name. And I want to hear you say your name. Now, let me tell you how I say my name. And you can practice saying your name the same way. I say my name, I take a breath, and then I say my last name. So I say my name, I take a pause. Listen, Audrey Smaltz. I don't say Audrey Smaltz. You know, come on down. Audrey Smaltz? Audrey Smaltz. Girl, you know I'm important. Now, you want to be important? Let me hear you say your name. Stand up. Try standing up. I want you to say your name. Don't say mine. And I know you guys got some fabulous names. And when they're really fabulous, take your time, because the other person didn't hear you. Because you're talking and nobody is listening. You know that? You know they're not listening. So you, I mean, say it like you, put your arms down here. Take a deep breath. And you say, hi.
Hi.
My name is.
My name is.
And then give it to me. This was good here. I heard the breath. I heard the breath. Okay, you're on. Let's hear him now. You're on.
Hi, my name is Robert Hildreth.
You got it.
Hello, my name is Katja Brandstetter.
Ooh, that's a big one. Excellent. And then you might want to say that last name again because they didn't hear that. That was excellent.
Brandstetter.
Wow, it's a mouthful. That's terrific.
Hello, my name is Jeru Kim.
Well, you didn't take that breath. Jeru Kim. Don't that sound better? Sit down. So now it's not when you're calling your mother and your father, your girlfriend and your boyfriend. This is when you're calling FIT. You're calling the ground crew. You're calling about a job. You must talk like you're somebody important. The young ladies who answer the phones at the ground crew, they'll say, Marissa Stapleton is on the phone, Audrey. I don't know Marissa Stapleton, or just any name I make up. And I say to them, well, how does she sound? Does she sound like she's gonna give us a job? Or does she sound like she's looking for a job? You know what, you can tell by just the way you're on the phone if you need something or if you're gonna give us something. So you want never to let that come out. Most of you young people say, like, oh, you know what I mean? Yes, like. So what did you say? Like, you know what I mean? As Judge Judy would say, is not the answer. You cannot say, You cannot say like in your conversation, like. That's when you pause. The magic of the pause. Did you notice that silence? That was magic. You can make magic by pausing. And on that note, Mr. Ronaldo Bernetti. Stand up. Mr. Rinaldo Brunetti, I told him many years ago when I met him, oh, you made that name up. You know you weren't born. Yes, he was born with that fabulous name. Can you imagine he didn't make up this name? Rinaldo Brunetti. You're going to remember that, right? He's an incredible fashion designer, and now he's the top designer or one of the lead designers. I know he's got a big, big title, make big books. For Badgley Mischka. It's very important that you know how to speak on the phone. Now, some of the things that have gotten me over in life, I'm not going to give you my whole background. It's not necessary. Be happy. Have fun. Travel. Meet interesting people and be nice. Be nice. Be courteous. Open the door for somebody. Help somebody. Look at somebody in the eye when you're talking to them. Hello? She's taking notes. Look at people when they're talking to you. Listen to people. Don't just hear them. Listen. Now that's another lesson in itself, listening. I love what I do. I do it all the time. We work for Nordstrom, we work for Bergdorf, we work for Saks Fifth Avenue. We do shoots. We have makeup artists, hairstylists. The ground crew has grown. And I want to tell you how I got that name. I heard Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King speak many years ago in Harlem. At the Convent Avenue Baptist Church, it was the spring of 1965. I didn't start my business until November 77. And I didn't start using the name Ground Crew that I could prove until 1982. I had to have it because I'm trademarked and registered the whole, and you had to show when you first used it. I probably used it before, but I couldn't find affidavits. So Martin Luther King won the Nobel Peace Prize on December the 10th, 1964. And in that very short speech that took maybe 7 or 8 minutes, he said in two references, "Every time I take a flight, I am always mindful of the many people who make the flight a successful journey. Who make a successful journey possible. The known pilots and the unknown ground crew." And the next reference, it says, "You honor the ground crew without whose labor and sacrifices the jet flights to freedom would never have left this earth." So I always put that together. I don't know how, why, but these are things that you remember, and you don't know how you remember them. And that was 65 when I heard him say it. He did it in the Nobel Peace Prize. And for 27 years, I was trying to find that speech. On one of my birthdays, a friend of mine handed me a book, and I cried. I knew I heard him say it. I had made up all kinds of things around what he meant by it because I couldn't find any reference to it. It took 27 years, but I would say the ground crew. Well, yes, you have the pilot and the co-pilot and the flight attendants, but who are the people that get that plane on that runway? The people who clean the plane. The people who serve the food on the plane, who get the food there, the people who are given the signals. These are people that you don't see. That plane cannot take off without what? You could have said a little louder than that. And I always say, and then it's the same with a ground crew backstage at a fashion show, getting those models on the runway in the right dress at the right time online. Hair, makeup, boom, 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 ba-da, boom, boom. They want the bracelet on this hand, you know, some don't want the bracelet here, want the handbag here, da-da. Online, ready to hit that runway. Oh, I used to model too. I didn't tell you that. That's how I came up with that name. You are gonna come up with a name. You may not wanna come up with your own name. Halston lost his name. How many of you remember Halston? Can you imagine? I think that kind of, he died soon after. You know, he couldn't use his name. Can you imagine you have a name and you cannot use it? Huh? A corporation bought it. There are a lot of people like that who have these fabulous names and they can't use it anymore. So think about that too. I'm not saying anything's gonna happen, but things happen. So whatever it is that you want, you can have it, it's possible. But how are you gonna go about getting it? You don't have to answer me now. This is what I wanted to do. When I turned 40, I said for the next 40 years, I wanna be in business for myself, but all of my clients, I work for them. So I do work for myself, and people say to me, many times I see people, and they look at me and they say, well, Audrey, what exactly do you do? You know the pause, what? You see, the pause is a deep breath. They ask me, what exactly do you do?
What exactly do you do?
As I please. Don't you like that answer? You gotta be up there young. You understand? Up there young before you can say that. I love it. I do as I please. It's a pleasure. I love doing what I do. Can you imagine people say, girl, I hate going to work today, and they come up with an excuse. Now, that's another thing. Excuses, don't make them. I heard it already. Your boss has heard it already. The train was late. The bus didn't show up. My grandmother died. I had to go to the hospital. I was in emergency. The baby couldn't get a babysitter. You know this week how many I heard? Huh? And I have two young ladies who are here with me today who've been working in the office and also working, doing some of the fashion shows. So they can tell you've heard a few excuses, haven't you? Yeah, they're shy. Amanda, stand up. Amanda's here from FIT. Then give Amanda a hand. And Nafisa is here from Chicago, my intern. And a wonderful young man who came to our seminar. Because you can't be a ground crew and a dresser without us training you our way. And that's Zadrian with a Z, not Adrian. He just came this year. He's fantastic. I'm not saying that these girls are not fantastic. I know that. But this young man has gone out of his way, and all of my supervisors have noticed. Oh, they call me on the phone. Zandrian, very good, Audrey. Very helpful. Very this, that. This is important. You want to be able to stand out in that crowd. Not by being loud. I'm loud. By being unique. We're all God's children and we're perfect in every way. But what's gonna make you outstanding in your crowd? Don't answer that. Just put that back there. Why are you, young man, gonna succeed to the highest? Don't answer me. Think about it. Because you've got it. And she's taking notes, and guess what? And you've got it too. Do you believe you have it? I know you're here in school. You're here at the best class. You're learning something from people in this field. I love what I do. I go on vacation, I travel. I have fun. What else?
Make money.
Yeah. What? And I make money. And I help other people. I think that's the most important thing, that I can help young people. They come into the ground crew, they listen to me for a couple of months, they work with me, and then that's nice. And then all of a sudden, a couple of years, 5, 10 years later, Audrey, they call, you remember what you said to me? No, sweetheart, what did I say to you? You said so-and-so, and I'm doing so-and-so, and I... And so many people over these many years have come to me, been very fortunate. They come through friends, through somebody. Like Jean Golly sent Amanda to me because she's the head of the volunteers. Not the volunteers, the internship. She's involved with the internship here at FIT. And Nafisa came through a friend of mine who I've known for many, many years. And I don't know how... Zadrian, how did you hear about us?
I actually read the Ebony magazine.
Oh, he read Ebony magazine. Okay, he read Ebony. They had a big story in there about me. But I just want you to do what you want to do. And if you really want to learn something about fashion, because I put you right into it, if you ever want to intern, we pay you. We don't pay you a lot of money now. We don't pay you. You get something. And lots of perks. Perks are good. And you can go right to the internet and look and learn all about the ground crew. I'm going to have my young assistant here, who's technical, not right yet, to tell you about how to get to the ground crew, because I know you know how to do that on that internet. You guys know everything but the email. I didn't get my email. You shoot me an email. The phone doesn't ring so much anymore. Did you shoot me an email? Did you get it? And then you text me. You know, I'm not from that era, but I'm trying to get in here with the texting and you know, back to hit me back and, you know. Yes, indeed. But I don't care what you do with all of that. If you don't know how to say your name over a telephone, I know you know how to spell it, but more important than spelling it on that email, honey, is saying your name. My name is... There you go. That's it. You never said it like that before, I bet. No. Because you did? You've been saying it like that? No. You have to say your name with feeling, with personality, with love, with vigor, vitality. I don't care how much you were on that email and listening to this. You must be able to speak. You hear me? And no ums, like, you know what I mean. And on that note, I'm Audrey Smaltz, thanking you for this time. Until the next time, I'm ready for questions. If you have a question, because I know I didn't answer everything, you have to stand up and ask me the question. You were the first hand to go up.
Good afternoon. My name is Mariam Conde.
Your name is Monica?
Mariam Conde. Mariam Conde.
Marianne?
Conde.
Well, you didn't breathe. Marianne.
Mariam Conde.
Are you Haitian?
Guinean, West African.
West African. I could hear that French. Yes, now you got to take, you know, you have that accent. Yep. So you have to use it to your ability. I need water. And then, okay, sweetheart.
Okay, my question was, how do you go about getting these, the design, to work for the designers? You call them up or do you...
How do you go about getting to work for a designer? Yeah.
Like, what's the process to get a job?
There's so many processes. Women's Wear Daily, I think Wednesday they have any designers that are... looking for jobs, but if I wanted to work for a designer, I would have an excellent resume. You have an excellent resume? Who looked over your resume?
The internship.
Oh yes, and it's perfect. Your resume? It's not perfect, so you got to have a good resume. This is the way I would do it, the old-fashioned way. I would not. A lot of people want you to shoot them that resume, don't they? That's so boring. I'd shoot it to them. And then I'd send it to them by mail in a bright color. All of my stationery, I have green, turquoise, hot pink, orange, yellow. I don't have white stationery. Everybody has white stationery, right? You try to be different. Maybe your resume would be so fabulous that, oh, I want to meet her. You have to make what it is that you want outstanding, different, unique, yours, individual, so that you can get to meet that designer. So who did you want to meet? She don't know.
I have some.
You know how long it took her to get that answer? Who do you want to meet? Come on, no. You're supposed to know right away who you want to meet. Who do you want to meet? She wants to meet John Galliano.
Gestier.
Ralph Rucci.
And Donna Cameron.
So there are two possibilities, because John Galliano's in Paris. Gestier's in Paris. You going to fly to Paris? She would like to. Come on. Let's make this possibility soon, not in the future, 2-5 years from now. So there's Donna Cameron. I would send a nice resume to Donna Cameron, but it has to be unique. And then I would find out all the people who work around Donna Cameron to get to know who they are. I could tell you. Because I have been working for Donna Cameron. I'm her oldest, longest outside contractor from her very first fashion show. I must be doing what? Something right, huh? Ralph Rucci. I do his show too. There you go. So you got a start already. Next question. What? You had a question.
My name is Anna Cho.
Not bad. Let's try it again. My name is
Anna Cho.
Doesn't that sound better? You hear the difference, don't you? Please say yes. Okay, Anna.
When your last day at Ebony was like August 31st, when you knew you wanted to start your own business, you had a little bit of savings, how did you know how many people you needed?
It was just me.
It was just you?
Well, I was lucky. I couldn't afford to hire somebody. I just started my business.
So was you just running the whole fashion?
No, I had a phone. I had to answer the phone. I had to do a lot of stuff for myself. Then I got my niece to work for me for $50 a week. She helped me out. We weren't getting any jobs then. We were trying to get some jobs. We were marketing, you know, out there telling people we need some jobs. And then I had another girl who was working with me part-time. She was getting $10 a day, you know. But you don't have to hire people until you have some business. And then when you have some business, you're going to ask a few people, how many people do you think I need for this job? That comes way late. That doesn't happen the first year you were in business. Not really. Now, unless you do something really exciting, you have a whole lot of money to start out with. I told you I started out with $60,000. It was gone in 3 months. Gone. No, it's not. That's not it. That's not it. Because tell me the business you want to start. That's not the answer. What's the business you want to start?
Well, I want to have my own bridal.
You want your own bridal business. So how much money do you need to start your own bridal business?
A lot.
A whole lot. A whole lot. I'm glad you know that. No, that's not funny. A whole lot. And why am I coming to you to get my bridal gown? I could get married again too, you know. Why should I come to you? Tell me. Tell me, Miss Cho. Tell me why I should come to you.
Because.
Would you go find it up there? Or are you going to look at me to tell me, just like I tell a client why they need the ground crew? You see how important it is to speak? What makes you so unique that I should come to you for a bridal gown? I'd love to come to you for a bridal gown. You'd be much less expensive than Vera Wang. And Vera's my client too. She has dresses for $50,000 and it doesn't even have a bead on it. Why should I come to you and not to Vera Wang? You're going to give me something. So see what you have to work on? You know you need a lot of money, a lot. But if I was you, I would work for a Vera Wang or an Amsala Abera. Or I would start right out at Kleinfeld's. Mm-hmm. Ursula is there. You should have her come speak.
Yes.
At Kleinfeld's, Ursula. Yeah, Ursula, she needs to come. You need to go to Kleinfeld's. And Ursula, find out who she is. She's fabulous. Get the right spelling of her name and mention my name. No, I'm serious. Kleinfeld, they got all kind of bridal gowns. They do a heck of a business. Next question.
Hi, I'm Jasmine Blarian, and I wanted to know, it's obvious that you have a really like larger than life persona, and you must be great at what you do, obviously, but I know it helps to convince people to hire you. So I want to know if you always had that presence.
Alice has known me for over 36 years. Have I had this presence? Since I was thinner, not taller, thinner, not shorter, thinner. Yes, it helps. I had one boss to tell me, I don't know, can I say BS here?
Yes.
I had the boss tell me, oh, you are so full of BS. You know what that stands for, don't say it. Don't take a pause. You know what it means. And she said that to me one day. I said, you know, you're right, because that's what I get over. I get over. It's just, you know, it's my persona. That's how I get over. She said it was that, and I said, fine. Whatever gets you over, it may be the softness of your voice, the quiet of your personality, the gentleness of who you are. That's not me. You have to find who you are and work it. You understand? And work it. Your eyes look great, you know? You can get, and you know when you're on the phone, I know you're only on the phone walking in the street doing stuff, but see, when I'm on the phone selling, I'm looking at myself in a mirror. I got mirrors everywhere in that hole. I'm smiling at myself. It works. It works, but you guys are on the cell phone. You never have a mirror. You better start carrying a mirror. Girl, it works. Look at yourself when you're on the phone. Another designer just came in. Mr. Stephen Cutting, I don't believe it. All of my friends. And I met him right here at FIT. I don't know how many years ago, Stephen?
1981.
Oh! You see how young I am? 1981.
Wow.
One more question. Okay.
Good afternoon. My name is Adrian Smith. And my question for you is, you deal with such a vast variety of designers in terms of couture versus small designers. How do you decide your price tag for yourself?
The same.
The same for everyone.
It's the same for everyone. That every season, I have one designer that I will do it for pro bono, but I pay the people. My people still get paid. I don't get paid. Every season. And one season many years ago, in fact, two seasons, I did my free show for Isabel Toledo, and that was in 1991. And her husband, Ruben, drew the most beautiful thank you note for me that I have framed. And whatever I was charging in 1991 can't compare to my beautiful painting that I have today. So sometimes, you charge the same to everyone, but every night you have a little twist. But a brand new designer, and if I like you, see, that's when I tell you, people must like you. If I don't like you, forget it. If I like you, but that's not just me, that's human nature. No, you had your question. So just show them my website. Oh, girl, you together now. What about the sound? This is my website. Go there, send me an email, shoot me an email. Please don't call me on the telephone, I'm busy. And if you do call me, you better say your name right. But this is you just go to groundcrew.net. Oh, it said so right there, waiting for. Oh, waiting for. Don't you hate when they have to wait for something? What's taking so long?
Oh, the sound?
No, just say they're waiting.
No.
What does it say they're waiting? That's like when I go to my Chase Manhattan, oh, that's not old Chase Manhattan, when I go to the Chase Bank, waiting. It was waiting. Well, anyway, you just can go there because it says we have professionals, service runway shows. Well, I don't know what's going on. Anyway, that's what happens with those computers, honey. I like the old-fashioned way, but we do have this computer. You can see the designers we work for. We love what we do, and if you're interested in working and making some money, not a lot, but you make money, it's not free, come and see us. I have something for you. Now, I don't know whether I have one for everybody, but you can stand over here, Nasifa and Amanda. They're gonna give out the first ones who get here. You stand over there and give it to them. That's some publicity so you can read more about who I am. And if you want to say hello to me, I'm here to shake your hand, even though I'm busy today. Let me see what show is on. Tony Cohen is on right now, and right after Tony Cohen, it's Gotex, okay? But if you want to see me, thank you.
She's fabulous.
Who? Deborah? Peyton Jones, of course. Thank you.
tour is occurring as we speak in the neighborhood in Ohio. Couture will always exist. It's unfortunate in your generation you've seen this whole transformation where the couture house becomes a vehicle for just selling nail polish and not clothes. And that disturbs me tremendously. And that's quite frankly one of the reasons why we went ahead with couture so vigorously and realistically, making clothes that really work, clothes that are for sale, and not just lipstick or red carpet treatment. But couture will always exist. Do you? You can stay. You're going to go to Paris, and you're going to maybe take a class or classes at Champs in the Haute Couture. If you want to do that, that's the school that is the finest recommendation to get into couture houses. The other way is you can go there and begin to apprentice and learn in a couture house, and you have many to choose from. The huge ones that have hundreds of workers are the smaller ones. And by being in Paris, because if you decide you want to be in couture in Paris in that precise way of couture, because then you would apply yourself there. Here in the United States, I think there are some people that still do couture, and when you graduate, you can think it out, you can think about how you want to do this. Whether you stay in America and intern, or begin to apprentice here in an American house, or go to Paris. But there is clearly more possibility in Paris. Did I answer your question? Interrelated because what I try to do, and I'm not even physically and simply, is I then attempt to put it together. And I always say that it doesn't click until I feel like I'm taking dictation. And I just sit there, and it comes, and that's when I know what I'm doing in my life. All problems with the business, and trying to make these clothes, and getting them out, and retailers, and that behavior, and all that, takes second to that individual emotion, and physical and spiritual feeling of when I'm taking dictation. And then I'm convinced the reason why people, and we built this business, I am proud to say without any press backing, is because people on an unconscious level tap into all of this. Because I'm working on a common consciousness that we all share. That's the clearest way I can put it. No? Yes, sir.
My mother once asked my wife about how we did what we did. She was a lot of problems there, but I
that's you. Cool. I'm going to write that down. Everybody should write that. Thank you. Yes.
Yes. You know, I do those things with my mom was no longer here, my dad is, and they used to love that, those things, so I always did these things in Philadelphia. But, yeah, you're right, demographics work at so many levels, but no, I didn't share that experience. Yes?
I'm just wondering, who do you think some of the great editors are, and if it's possible to infuse their objectivity back into
an editor of art?
Like magazine editor.
Ooh, I think it was a great fashion magazine editor. I love that question. I've wanted somebody to ask me that question so we could get on this topic. She's a woman who I have a great honor to have known. She was a prophet. She made no sense. She was a genius. Her name is Dionne Vreeland. This woman, she would allow herself to be totally unconscious of her advertisers and her advertisers' dollars on her Christmas issue. And I show my staff sometimes, look at this issue, a 1964 Christmas issue, where she sent Lord Snowden to photograph horses. And then the next couple of pages are these great temples in Moscow, and she had Pauline de Rothschild write articles. And then she had Saint Laurent make her, just for the issue, chartreuse, big sack, and ball gowns. It was about genius and creativity. And half of the time you didn't know what she was talking about, it's all true. But she had such style and vision. She was a
visionary, and she was the greatest editor that we ever had. She, and my other one pick is Carmel Snow. Carmel Snow was at Harper's Bazaar, and she was different. She was quiet, she was discreet, always Mabel Scheer, Balenciaga. Those are the two. And in my lifetime, I worked with, there was a woman by the name of Igor, who was the firm fabricator at Harper's Bazaar. And she was one of my best friends. Yes? Who said that? Yeah.
And I was very young because I was still in a pretty new school of art at night, and I got this job as a study director. I have to talk about you. I adored her. And I dressed like a pretty new school student. There she is. She was the most elegant, right? She was and she said, oh,
yeah, I did too. We're talking about a woman. Well, I always say she taught me the importance of chalk brown. She did. Just quickly, I don't want to bore you, but this is somebody who came from the past. But after Mrs. Breathen was fired from Harper's Bazaar, Eve Orton had the character to say, I'm not staying here. So she left and she quit. And she went on, to become a consultant, and her big thing, this is the part that you'll like and you'll remember her, she brought two young Italian boys to this country, and she introduced them to Mrs. Engelhardt and Mrs. Onassis and Mrs. Pelli, and those two men were Valentino Benavani and Giancarlo Giannetta. And that's Eve's big claim to fame. She introduced Valentino to the world. But she was a great editor and a great friend of mine. Thanks for asking that question, because I miss those girls so much. I talked to them. The pictures in my office, I just talked to them.
So there I was, I come in, I'm so impressed with her, so I was about them, and but that was just a lot of chaotic, and it's like you did from all
The way you just spoke and asked that question shows me that you have it. And what do I think about it? I think it's one of the most refreshing, admirable, necessary ingredients for a human being to present themselves with a style and original grace. I think it's essential. When people don't, then I worry. It takes so much financial ability because you'll open your first season, the sample collection, we'll get through that. You sell it and you're shipping. Okay, as you're shipping, nothing's coming in. Now some people prepay or put up a deposit or something, but you're in an industry of very dishonest people. And sometimes we don't want it after it's made. So there's a loss there. So you can't foresee any of this. What I suggested earlier to somebody is to have some experience, gain some experience, and then while you're gaining the experience, think about a marketing plan of presenting yourself, and think about either an individual that you might know, individuals, a group of individuals that believe in you, but remember, once you take their money, it's a whole different relationship, because money is the factor that eliminates friendship. So, and also, I hate to tell you this, but you live in my world also. There's no such thing as a bank giving any individual money for a startup business in New York. You see what's happening. People can't buy homes. We're in a horrible, horrible recessionary period. Especially if you walk into the bank and say, I am so divided. Look at this work. I'm going to start my own fashion business. Bye. So, I mean, when I was starting in the 70s, you had more leeway in people lending money or banks helping out. So I don't know what answer to give you. I wish I did. All I can say is get some experience first. So with the experience, you'll have a little more savvy ability to look. If you're going to do it, if it's meant, you're going to do it. Nothing's going to stand in your way. But it's just so important to realize that the financial hurdle could set you back emotionally. And that's what we don't want to happen.
What about if you were to create small collections and sell this to specialty
teams?
Just to keep you, the creativity of what you're doing alive
in between? Yes, terrific idea. But the problem is, right now, present change, I hope, will in 6 months. Even those boutiques are carrying excess stock. So you need to be replenished every 6 months as you're supplying them for your cash flow. And if they don't need the replenishment, where is your cash flow? Because you're already making the merchandise. So, in Italian, piano, gradual, slow, yes. I was ready to carry up. I will do this, and this worked. And I was having all of these setbacks continuously. So I realized I was sitting around in one room studio apartments. I had been waiting for something to occur. And so I thought, no, this is not going to work for me. And that's why I showed the first collection in 1980. And I couldn't afford to. I pushed the rack to the hotel. Made and cut and designed the collection myself. But if you're so passionate, you can't contain it, you feel it inside, you'll just do it. And the universe of God helps you work it out. I'm convinced. I'm proof. That's a beautiful question, because I always complain to those closest to me, especially the movie collection. When we have the show in 3 weeks, I spend 90% of my time in business and 10% as a designer. It's terrible. Because then what happens is I have to rush, and I have to prepare in a rush back. I mean, I start fabric development and prints and artwork in advance. But when we're really doing it, and it's not shared tremendously with my staff, because everybody's working around the clock, everybody's rushed, emotions are raw, nerves, I'm trying to make everybody laugh. But the business is such that I don't have a business partner, and so I have to be involved with everything, in every decision, and then the meetings that take so much time. So what I do, to answer your question specifically, I have a home that I love to go to, as a sanctuary, to run home, I don't talk, I don't take a phone, I love my home. I exercise every day except Sunday, or I sleep late. And I have dear friends that I see, and I have a wonderful English bulldog. That's what. Are you ready? You know his name is. My dog's name is Tom. That's not true. We have so many young people that come from FIT and from Parsons and other schools and intern with us. No, we always groom and take young people in, especially. There's one young girl in my office, Samantha, and she screens all the people. And don't be afraid of that. I heard you say that. But this young lady was just saying, did you hear her say that? She's talking about how she appreciates history of fashion and the arts that go along with it, and she feels sometimes that it's almost a defeatist possibility because she cannot get a work visa, or you also isn't maybe go to Europe. You can do anything you want. I'm not part of the industry. And Pucci. There is a man, his name is Ralph Pucci, and he has a furniture collection and a mannequins. He designs mannequins. And we're often, we've never met, but people always say that, oh, your new collection of furniture, and I'm a closet case decorator, so I would love to do a again, you're in an area, and I've already done some consultant work for people who are more than I. You're in an area, and if we're going to work on high-quality products for the home, where do you make them? Okay, so then you go to a little boutique company, and then they can't supply you fast enough. And then where do you sell them, where do you distribute? So then inevitably just takes, there is no money to be made in an area like that, unless you become a, let's say, a small division within a big company like McGuire Furniture, or I would love to. I would love to go to the home. In linens and things like that. Yes? Together. So I had already felt, not just decided, I was in this position of being alone within this industry. And I pursued exactly what I wanted to pursue. And we built the business very, very gradually. And we built it through the help of Neiman Marcus, not buying clothes. Yes, they did. The way we really built the business is I would do all of the trunk shows myself. You know what trunk shows are, where you take the entire collection to a given city. And that's where I built the relationship with clients that over the years brought more and more trust. Thus, when I grew, used better fabrics, more complication, and the clothes became so expensive, this is how I amassed an audience. And it was through the kindness of one woman. There was a fashion director at Neiman Marcus. Her name was Joan Kaner. And she was my great angel, and she introduced us to Neiman Marcus, and that's how we grew the business. Now, where we are right now is a place that we're trying to define and to understand, because I don't quite know. We have a business, it needs to expand with control, and what we're trying to do is, by editor to editor, re-evaluating what we think about them and presenting ourselves to them so they could have a renewed idea of what I'm about. Because in the process, I alienated some people. And that's very disturbing. I didn't alienate out of intention. It occurred because of survival. I couldn't afford a cutter or a shipping agent. So I would cut all of my clothes all night long, or ship boxes all night long. And I wouldn't politically play with the process. It was a negative event there. But we're trying to make corrections about the way people perceive you. That's a very good question. Because there are specific situations that occurred in my life that if I don't I love this profession so much. It sickens me that just a handful of people have tried to destroy it. But we can talk about that. Yes. With whom?
The whole world for your late coming into the picture, the limelight. So do you think at this stage you would want to make any changes? Do you think you could have done something differently which would have improved the thing?
Sure. One could always say one could have been more polite and kind and generous and quiet to listen. I was so hell-bent on keeping everything in the air, struggling to survive, that perhaps I wasn't as quiet as I should have been. Yeah. Yes?
One thing that interests me very much, and I'm curious how I feel about it, is this whole world that we have in America, which to me seems like our version of the war, but and that is like still finding new tracks.
You mean the artists in quality of certain individuals and pieces of the country that participate?
Yeah,
absolutely. Actually, we work with a man from New Hampshire, a Japanese gentleman, that does hand-carved wooden pieces. And we give him concepts to season, like this season, to a tray, and all of our bags are built from wooden trays. Yes, I think artists and communities are essentially couture because it's all handwork. So, absolutely. I mean, for years I worked with the glove maker. He's a genius at making gloves. His name is Daniel Storto. And he is all the way up in Gloversville. He does all the work by hand. Now I happen to have his nice wife working for me, so we have our own gloves. But it's essential. And you know something? You might want to think about that.
I'm very serious.
Yeah, as something very individual for you to pursue with your studies in accessories. Yes?
With the way things have become so homogenized in the market, I don't know if you read the book Deluxe.
Yeah.
And, I was thinking about how would you preserve your own name after you're no longer in design? Have you thought about that?
That's a very good question. Yes, I have. Because I have to, of course, do a will and foundation, all that sort of thing. I don't believe that a house can continue after the nucleus of designer and the participants are no longer. Because that's what the house meant. And I'll just give you an example. I think the work that Riccardo Tisci is doing in Givenchy is quite wonderful. But on a moral level, there's a great living legend that isn't being treated with the correct respect. So my, as if I were to be cremated or someone, if something happens to me, there's no longer a house. But the one thing that we are going to continue, and I was adamant after all these years to finally get it right, is the fragrance. We have the fragrance, and that will continue.
This is unfortunately,
we're getting kicked out because of the union.
But the formality, the life, and
the union.